practical seamanship, line with block and tackle. One characteristic of a good seaman is his ability to work with fiber line. To be able to do this, they must know the characteristic and properties of the fiber line, how to handle and care for the line, and tie the basic knots, bend, and hitches. Fiber line is made of either vegetable or synthetic fiber. Vegetable fiber includes manila, sisal, hemp, cotton, and flax. Synthetic fiber includes nylon, dacron, polyethylene, polypropylene, and others. Manila is a strong fiber that comes from the leaf stem of the abaca plant that is in the banana family. Varying in length from 4 to 15 feet in their natural state, the fiber have the length and quality to give manila rope relatively high elasticity, strength, and resistant to wear and deterioration. Most lines used in the army are manila. Sisal is made from sisalna, a species of agave plant. Although sisal is seldom used in the army, it is covered here because it is good substitute for manila. Sisal fiber are normally 2 to 4 feet long. Sisal can withstand exposure to seawater very well. Hemp is a tall plant that has useful fiber for making rope and cloth. It was used extensively before the manila was introduced. Now hemp's principal use is in fittings such as red line and marline. Because hemp is absorbent, the fittings are invariably tar to make them more water resistant. Nylon is made from mineral product which is waterproof, absorbs shock, stretches and resumes to its original length. It also resists to abrasion, decay and fungus growth. Nylon is the primary synthetic fiber line used in the army and maritime industry. Fiber line is made by twisting fiber into yarns, yarn into strand and strand into the finish line. The fiber are twisted from left to right to spin the yarn. The yarn is twisted from right to left to form the strands, and the strands are then twisted from left to right to lay or form the line. Three-stranded nylon line is constructed in the same way as fiber line. Fiber line is measured in inches by 8 circumference. Small stuff is used for lashing material and heaving lines. Fiber between 1 and 3 quarter to 5 inches in circumference is referred to as line. Line over 5 inches in circumference is normally referred to as hawser. Hawser is often used for mooring and towing. Manila is the standard line against which all other types of fiber line are measured. It is implied in the measurement considered that all of the line have the same circumference. When working with line, it is essential that you do not overload it because doing so is dangerous and costly. An overloaded line may be part and injure someone in the vicinity. Even if it does not part, its useful life is shortened every time it is overloaded. For this reason, you need to know the line's breaking strength and safe working load. To determine the safe working load, the circumference of a line should be powered by 2 and multiplied to the constant provided. While for the breaking strength, to find the range in which it is safe and economical to operate, after knowing the line's safe working load, it should be regulated by their safety factor, which depends on its condition, whether new or old line. Hawser and line must be never stowed when wet. After they are thoroughly dry and clean, they should be stowed in a dry, unheated, well-ventilated area or locker. And line can be coiled, flemish or faked down. Wire rope is made of steel except for its core, which some of it could be fiber. The grades of wire rope in descending order of strength are extra improved plow, and mild plow steel. The manufacturer will stamp the grade on the steel, but because the grade of wire rope is not visually apparent, it should be always considered as plow steel when in doubt. The basic unit of wire rope is individual wire. Wire are laid together to form strands. The number of wires in strand varies according to the purpose of which the wire is intended. Strands are laid around the core to form the wire rope itself. With preformed plow steel wire rope, or some of the core may be hemp or polypropylene, a synthetic fiber, the core is the foundation to keep the wire rope round and to act as a shock absorber when the wire rope contact under strain, as well to serve as a reservoir for lubricants. The safe working load for wire calculations will be using diameter instead of circumference compared to fiber lines, and the resulting unit is normally in tons. Wire rope should be inspected frequently, and frayed, kinked, worn, or corroded rope should be replaced. How frequently rope should be inspected depends on the amount of it used. Worn or weak spot shows up as shiny flat spots on the wire. If the outer wire have been reduced in diameter by one half, the wire rope is unsafe. Broken wire also show where the greatest stress occur. If individual wire are broken next to one another, unequal load distribution at this point will make the rope unsafe. These broken wire are called fish hooks. If you count 8 or more fish hooks, replace the wire rope immediately. Wire rope is lubricated when it is manufactured. The lubricant generally does not last throughout the life of the rope, which makes re-lubrication is necessary. Reversing ends is more satisfactory than just cutting ends because frequently the wear and fatigue on a rope are more severe at certain points than at others. Reversing distributes stronger parts of the rope to the points getting wear and fatigue. A block is a set of pulleys or sheaves mounted on a single axle. An assembly of blocks with the rope threaded through the pulleys is called tackle. A block and tackle system amplify the tension force in the rope to lift heavy loads and redirect it. The rope is threaded or rove through the pulleys to provide mechanical advantage. A wooden block consists of one or more sheaves or pulleys. Each block has one or more steel straps which strengthen the block and support the sheave pins. The front of the block is called its face and the side of the shell are called cheeks. Metal blocks have basically the same parts as wooden blocks. Only the metal block has bolts to hold its cheeks together and a metal shell. There are many types of block out there. Some of them are the single sheave block that has only one sheave and may or may not have the hook or bracket. The multiple sheave block contains two or more sheaves. It also may or may not have a hook or bracket. The snatch block has a hinge cheek on one side and differs from all other blocks. The advantage of a snatch block over the others is that it can be opened and a bite of line can be placed over the sheave without passing the end of the line through the swallow. The head or heel block has cast metal shell, roller bearings and grease fitting in the sheave pins. The cargo runner can pass over this block at the head and heel of the cargo boom. Blocks may be single, double, treble and so on. They may be fitted with 1, 2, 3 or more sheaves respectively. When used in tackle, one of the block must be fitted with bracket to which one end of the line is spliced. When hook, shackle, swivel and others are fitted on the blocks, they are called rigs. Tackle are designated in two ways. One is the number of sheaves in the block that are used to make the tackle, such as single whip, gun tackle, jigger or two-fold purchase. The other designation is according to the purpose of which the tackle is used, such as yard tackles, stay tackles or fore and aft tackles. The mechanical advantage of a simple tackle is determined by counting the number of parts of the moving lines at the movable blocks. The movable blocks is the block that is attached to the wake to be moved. To calculate the effort required to lift any object, a formula of effort equals to burden divided by mechanical advantage, or F, force equal to W, weight divided by mechanical advantage, MA. Let's take a look at this example for better understanding. If a two-fold purchase combination used to lift a 40 kg box, how much effort or force in kilogram is required? We identify the weight is 40 kg and the mechanical advantage for two-fold purchase is 4 as the line bear and the burden to move the weight is 4. So the required force is 10 kg. However, if we consider the friction of the system in real world, additional force need to be added, and it is roughly 10% from the weight on each sheave. Expanding from the above, the total force or effort required is now 14 kg. For all of this equipment, it is important to do a regular maintenance, such as cleaning and slashing standing riggings, slashing down the running riggings, maintain the blocks, shackle and turnbuckle, boat davits, winches, cranes and anchor windlasses. Well, that's all for now. Thank you.